This is Frank Morris trying to get out of an i8.
Yeah. did fall off last time. That's the first time it's fallen off.
Yeah, pretty much, hopefully. At some point I might possibly go on ahead if it's taking a bit long.
Yeah, that's
so if I go on ahead, I go on, but otherwise I'll try and lead the way.
We're sort of miss the bits when we arrive, aren't we?
Well, we have to be quick when we get... Yeah. Are you ready to leave then?
We are, yes.
Okay. Okay, so I'm going straight over this island, straight down to the main, across the A45, yeah. Chief yeah. Lane. Head Macadam. If I go wrong, just ignore me. Just you okay. Go your way.
We will. All right.
Okay. All right. See you later. Yeah.
Listen and you'll hear the sound. Hear the sound of a heart breaking. I can still see you standing there. Midnight wind blowing through your hair. Remember kisses sweet in the salty air. When love was forever. Turn the page and we fade to blue. The scene has changed, now I'm without you. Well, you just walked away when the act was through and the dream was over. It was almost like a movie, the way you said goodbye. You must have spent a lot of time rehearsing each and every line. Now there's not a dry eye in the house. After the last curtain comes down, listen and you'll hear the sound of a done. It's just history. The last act is over. Your every line had the sweetest sound. Your every touch turned my world around. But then the lights came up and my world crashed down. In the show, it's over. We touch the stars. Times that still feel when I know it's sad enough.
Listen and you'll hear the sound. Hear the sound of a committed no crime, and bad mistakes I've made a few. I've had my shells and kicked in my bed, but I've come through.
I need to go on.
I'm not afraid to
I pray for soul. Some days I just pray to the god of sex and drums and rock and roll. And maybe I'm lonely, that's all I'm qualified to be. That's just one and only promise I can keep. As long as the wheels are turning, as long as the fires are burning, as long as your thrills are coming true, you better believe it, that I would do anything for love. And you know it's true, and that's a fact. I would do anything for love, and there'll never be no turning back.
But I'll never do it better than I do it with you. So long, so long. And I would do anything for love. Oh, I would do anything for love. I would do anything for love. But I won't do that. No, 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 I won't do that.
Will you raise me up? Will you help me down? Will you get me right out of this godforsaken town? Will you make it all
seated. Good afternoon, and thank you for gathering to support Debbie and Frank's family today. My name is Sarah Bertram, and I'm a civil funeral celebrant. This afternoon, you will remember Frank here in the chapel, at the graveside, and later at the Holiday Inn for refreshments, to which you are all most warmly invited. Details are on your order of service. Also on the order of service are details of two charities whom you may wish to support in Frank's memory. Sometimes there are no words adequate, no words that can come near to soften the blow when faced with the shock of a sudden and unexpected death such as Frank's. There is great pain and deep sorrow that such a thing can happen. This is not how it was meant to be. This was not in your script, yet here we are. You have gathered to say farewell, or perhaps au revoir, and to express your thanks for how Frank's life uniquely touched yours. We shall begin by hearing our reflections, by hearing words written by Frank's father, Richard. Mark.
It is a privilege to be able to read this eulogy to Frank on behalf of his father, Richard, my uncle. These are his words. It's not supposed to be like this. Parents normally die before their children. They say that this is the worst thing that can happen. Maybe, maybe not. But all we know is that we are suffering a grievous sense of loss. One minute he was there as ever, available for a chat or for advice, to be relied on if support was needed at any time. The next minute, he was just no longer there. That is hard. Think of his life as a book spanning half a century. Judy and I were the co-authors of the early chapters. Then increasingly, it became an autobiography with contributions from many others. Very few of us have read it from cover to cover, and some of us were continually dipping into it. Others will have read parts of it in much more detail. The book is now closed. How much do the authors, alias parents, know about the characters in their book? Everything and nothing. Everything until they go to school, then as they make their own way in the world, less and less. And so it was with Frank. Like all parents, we made mistakes, but sometimes we can trace back his interests to our positive influence. His outstanding technical computing skills. He grew up in parallel to the growth in personal computing. We bought Sinclair ZX81, Spectrum, and BBC Micros in succession, and he spent hours on them. Working for IBM, not that I was that technical, I may have been a role model, but he soon outstripped me and left his formal education far behind. And others will have contributed to successive chapters in the book far more than ever I was able to. He was incidentally an excellent touch typist. Did he follow me in this respect after I laboriously taught myself on a portable typewriter? He went to typing lessons at school along with all the budding secretaries. He didn't care what people thought. His cycling expeditions. We were so pleased that he completed Land's End to John O'Groats, and they were able to be there to greet him and Pete at the finish. The original influence may have been our family's cycling holidays, 2 weeks starting from home and touring Essex and Suffolk, or train with bikes to Thurso and touring the Cork Orkney Islands. I'd like to think this gave him the idea. He loved cooking. This must have been inherited or learned from his mother. As a child, he had a very limited diet, consisting mainly of sausages and peas. And I have an abiding memory of delivering something to his student lodgings in Nottingham to find him wearing an apron and cooking a sausage pie. He went on to become an expert in Indian cuisine, much respected by his Asian colleagues and friends. And to our benefit, there are still some frozen curries in our freezer. The chapters on drones. He became a qualified pilot, and virtual reality owed nothing to us. We were bowled over by the beautiful and highly professional drone videos that he created, and I shall always treasure them. He made full use of the lovely Cumbrian countryside in this, and we were so glad that he and Debs visited us just 3 weeks before his untimely death, and that he was able to see his sister and niece for the first time in 2.5 years and take advantage of the beautiful weather and crystal clarity of the air that weekend to get some amazing footage of our village from high up. The stills that he sent me from that will always be my personal memorial. And what about the cats? Where did that come from? We never had pets due to bad youthful experiences with dogs, and Judy was allergic to cats, and I never understood them. Yet he loved his cats, took in homeless strays, saw they had the best food, and paid their vet's bills. There may have been a pointer from his youth. We did have some goldfish, which we won at a fair, and he called them Willie, Dick, and Pearl. They died as goldfish do, and he was heartbroken. He cared deeply for other creatures. His delightful sense of fun owed nothing to his parents. I can only assume it was inherited from his paternal great-grandmother. Not that he ever knew her, but as I recall, they shared the same love of corny jokes, repeated over and over again. Many people will remember his generosity. Many a time, some gadget or other would be delivered to us unannounced, and often we could even make use of them. This extended to everything he did. And after visiting us and taking over our kitchen, he would leave many a curry in the freezer. If it was labelled for one, you could be sure there was more than enough for two. But it has to be said, the raw materials, they were usually ours. We are so much the poorer now that the last chapter has been written. But they also say that your relationship with a person can continue to develop even after their death. And I do hope that this proves to be the case. But I shall always regret not being able to learn more about and experience the virtual reality that he was becoming increasingly interested in. May you rest in peace, my son. And may there be a virtual reality somewhere in which your spirit can soar into the skies, where your drones made you so happy. And I am sure you will be up there watching over us to the end of our days. This would be a fitting epilogue to a lovely book.
Thank you.
Now we shall hear the words of friend David Quinney.
It's July 1989. Frank and I are in Zurich in Switzerland. We're both students and we're taking a month to travel around Europe by train, interrailing. We were waiting for the only train to take us south. We had to get that train. In those days, Frank loved the Time Warp, the Rocky Horror Picture Show. You may remember the dance. It's to jump to the left, step to the right, put your hands on your hips, bring your knees in tight. Frank was committed to taking the song and the dance to Europe, whether Europe liked it or not. So we did. In the middle of the day, in Zurich main platform, two of us did the dance in front of all the commuters while we waited for our train. What a strange sight we must have been. Too skinny, Frank was smaller in those days. 6 foot tall, uncoordinated students in our shorts and our t-shirt, prancing around and thrusting our hips left and right, up and down. But something wasn't right. You see, Swiss trains are never late. And I realized to my horror that the train in front of us was actually our train. I shouted and screamed at Frank, "Get on the train." So we grabbed our things and ran to the across the platform, knocking over anybody in our way. Somehow we got that train door open and we fell inside. There was a fair amount of pandemonium on the platform. After all, they are Swiss. The train guard, of course, was furious. As the train pulled off, he ran down the platform, waving his flag and shouting and screaming at us. He was not a very happy man. I collapsed on the floor of that train, relieved we'd got the train. And Frank? Well, Frank was just rolling around the carriage in fits of laughter. You see, if there's one thing I think we can all agree today, is there was never a dull moment when Frank was around. He's always the first to open his arms and welcome you. So always the first to the bar to mix you a cocktail or two. Always the one with a joke to liven the mood. And if you let him, another joke and another joke and another joke. I met Frank when I was 9 years old. It's funny, I never set out to be his friend, and yet I can still remember the day we first met. We got into a bit of an altercation. There were two of us and one of him. He warned us that he did judo. My companion challenged him. The next moment, he found himself flat on his back. It was in that moment that I got a glimpse into his real personality, beyond the jokes. I can always remember the look in his face, in the eyes. There was a steely level of determination, of defiance, and underestimate me at my peril, at your peril. A group of us became friends. We discovered the early years of computing, gaming, programming. We cycled far and wide around the area. We discovered music together. For him, heavy rock. But it was always Frank that pushed the boundaries. It was always Frank that had to hack his computer. It was always Frank that had to find the perfect cocktail. It was always Frank that had to be the fastest on the bicycle. And when bicycles weren't fast enough, he moved to cars. And when cars weren't fast enough, he moved to motorbikes, terrifying any of us that would sit on the back as he zoomed past cars and anything that got in his way. You see, there was never a dull moment when Frank was around. At university, we did two grand tours together. His idea, I merely said yes, foolishly. The first, the interrailing, 6,000 miles around Europe by train. The second, we drove 4,000 miles along all of the east coast of America. Neither of us spoke a foreign language. In fact, neither of us really understood anything about American politics and divisions. And yet Frank made friends wherever he went on that tour. With his open arms, his broad smile, his cocktails, and of course that time warp. You see, there was never a dull moment when Frank was around. We went our separate ways after university. He moved to Solihull with Debbie, I went to London. We met up periodically. Then in 2014, I had a telephone call from him out of the blue. "Hey Dave, you know that thing that we always wanted to do at school?" "No." "You know, we're gonna, that cycle, Land's End to John O'Groats." It's like, "No Frank, that's never been on my to-do list." "Well, we're gonna do it. Get yourself training." It was January. "We're gonna meet up in August and we're gonna do it. Are you in?" "Why not?" And so we did. 1,000 miles of cycling. It was on that tour that I got to know Frank again, after all those years. The jokes were still there, but so too was that kid, still determined, still defiant. He was a big lad then, but I tell you, he could turn those pedals. He powered up and down those hills of Devon and Cornwall. He pedaled through the rain. He powered through 80 miles on one of the legs. He set the pace for me on that tour. It was on that tour that I also got to understand the importance of Debbie in his life. She was the balancing force, and he loved her dearly. It took Debbie to bash sense into both of us along that journey. Unfortunately, Frank had picked up a leg infection halfway along the journey, and a trip to the hospital said that his tour was over and mine had just begun. You see, there was never a dull moment when Frank was around. To his credit, Frank did the whole thing again the following year with Pete. Together, Frank and I raised £4,000 on that charity, but he also inspired me to do a charity event every year since 2014. And I thank him for that. We were exchanging texts up until the sad day he passed away. We both had COVID. He clearly not being well, but he said he was getting better. He talked about the future. He said he was gonna lose the weight. He was gonna get into the drone security business because, well, he had a real talent for both of those and also a real passion. "I want to do another cycle, Dave. I want to go and cycle the north of Scotland. Are you in?" "Sure, Frank, I'm in." I know Frank's with us today. He's actually at the back of the room, looking at his watch, cracking a few jokes. "Come on, Dave, get a move on," he's saying. "There's a party we've got to get to later." You see, there was never a dull moment when Frank was around. And on behalf of all of us, Frank, I'd like to thank you for each and every one of those moments. Thank you.
and last, but in no way least, we shall hear reflections written by Frank's wife, Debbie.
Although we'd only been married 12.5 years, I've had the honour of knowing our wonderful Frank for over 33 years. We first met at Nottingham Trent University, known as Trent Poly back then. In 88, Frank was doing a computer studies course and I was doing business studies. The way to meet people back then was to communicate via the Poly's email system, which we seemed to spend all day on. Frank arranged to meet me and a friend at the library later one day, and I remember his energy and confidence even then. As the conversation got going though, it soon became apparent that he was more interested in my friend, so I took a back seat and let them continue chatting. We arranged to meet Frank and his pals later that evening at the local student hangout, aka the Gooseberry Bush pub, and soon became good friends. Frank was into different things than me at the time though, heavy rock, Dungeons and Dragons and long leather trench coats, whereas I was more of a glam rock kind of girl, just starting to find my way in the big wide world. Many a Friday night would be spent with Frank and his pals though at Rock City, or as it was more affectionately known, Rock Sticky, as the carpets were constantly covered with spilt beer or cider in Frank's case, where we'd air guitar and headbang for hours on end. Our courses ended in 91 and Frank headed back to his hometown of Birmingham whilst I stayed in Nottingham. We still kept in touch though, as Frank's first job was an IT recruitment consultant, and he happened to get my then partner a job working at the same company too. As you can imagine, with Frank's talents for getting on with everyone and being so friendly, he became a gifted recruitment consultant in no time. Frank helped me find an IT job in Birmingham too, and my partner and I moved down there. I used to see Frank every day then, where he'd give my partner a lift into work. He was always so bright and chatty first thing, and was such a morning person. Unlike me, where I need at least 3 cups of tea before I could feel human. There used to be a large group of us who would go out, so I saw Frank most weekends as well. He had a partner, and so did I, and we remained good friends throughout those years with no romantic intentions. Fast forward a few years and Frank and I got together after we'd both split up with our partners. It started with phone calls on our way back from work. We shared the same playful good nature. As we'd grown older, we'd also found we had more in common. Frank loved cars, the cinema, and had a passion for his motorbike, which I was fascinated with. So much so that 2 years later, he decided to take me on a motorbiking holiday to France to see one of his friends who lived there and ran special motorbiking weekends. There were 12 of us on this particular weekend and we never stopped laughing the whole time. Except on the Saturday morning when Frank was being quite secretive with his friend. He borrowed a motocross bike and took me up the local mountain to a beauty spot called the Edge of the World. I remember the journey up being so uncomfortable on his bike and was keen to get to the top. Frank seemed unusually nervous that morning too, and as we got off the bike I soon realised why. He blindfolded me and took me closer to the edge. As he released the blindfold, he knelt down on one knee and proposed to me with this amazing scenery behind us. I started crying with love and joy and immediately said yes. We were married 2 years later on 1st of May 2009 at Coombe Abbey. I remember us both being so nervous that day, but we both spent weeks making sure it was planned perfectly and in tune with our daft personalities. And we both loved it, and everyone else seemed to too. We treasured the photos and keepsakes of the day, and often used our silver goblets to toast each anniversary. Frank loved spending time in the kitchen, concocting various tasty goodies, and remember buying him a masterclass course at our local Michelin-starred Indian restaurant as a birthday present. I never looked back. By the end of it, we became best pals with the owners there and used to swap recipes regularly and got free tips and advice. His Indian cooking skills were amazing before that course, but went up several notches afterwards, and he'd spend hours preparing meals from scratch using the finest ingredients. He was such a perfectionist. Frank's career had moved on again. His natural talent and curiosity for all things IT had been climbing the ladder quickly and had reached the level of group IT manager. He decided that he fancied a slight change of direction and had the opportunity of working for one of the big four consultancies as a cybersecurity consultant, and he jumped at the chance. Frank was well loved there and knew everyone from all the board members to the staff at the canteen. He used to bake fudge and Christmas cakes and take them in for all the staff, often with surprise ingredients like Carolina Reaper chilies and so much booze in his cake people had to get taxis home. Frank's love of drones was also building during this time, and he was fascinated with the footage that he'd record and the whole cinematography of it too. He spent hours in our dining room building his own drones and compiling stunning videos of places he'd flown his drones at, and became a valued member of the local aeromodelers flying club. The sheer amount of effort and attention to detail he'd applied to his movies was astounding. He was so immersed in it and ever the consummate professional. So that leads me to the final few months of our lives together. After nearly 2 years of being in various lockdowns, we finally managed to get back to Turkey last October, a place we both loved. We spent 2 weeks having the most amazing time, and Frank got to do a load of things he'd never had the opportunity of doing before. Looking back, it's like he knew something was going to happen and was trying to pack in as much as possible. Just before Christmas, he'd caught up with lots of friends he hadn't seen for years too, and we'd also spend the weekend just before Christmas seeing his mum and dad in Cumbria, and his sister Jen and niece Eva, who were over from Singapore. We also spent a lovely Christmas at home with my mum. Frank loved doing the cooking, and his Christmas dinner was one of the best ever. So, I'm not sure if I'm ready to say goodbye to you though, my love, as your final days seem to pass so quickly. I'm still coming to terms with the suddenness of you leaving, but know for sure that you've well and truly earned your place up there with the angels, shining with the brightest stars. To have known you, my lovely Hubble, all these years has been a true gift, and I feel blessed to have known you for so long. Thank you for being such an amazing husband, romantic, caring, and such a joy to live with. I take some solace in knowing that you're at peace now, laughing and joking with our loved ones in heaven, and looking down on us all with love and warmth. You'll be forever in my heart, my love, and may you rest in eternal peace.
Thank you all for those heartfelt words in tribute. And now, if you feel able, please join with me in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We are now almost at the end of our time here in the chapel, remembering Frank. In a few moments, my colleagues will return to escort us all to the graveside. But first, some closing thoughts in the form of a poem. Thy Will Be Done by Dorothy Frances Gurley. You left quietly, without a fuss. You always had a smile to share, a laugh, a joke, a time to care. A wonderful nature, warm and true. These are the memories we have of you. A beautiful life came to an end. You died as you lived, everyone's friend. You gave us years of happiness. Then sorrow came with tears. You left us lovely memories we will treasure through the years.
Hey, yo, people here. best you says you want more tears. You can make this painful high. You're talking about hey now, hey now, hey now, hey now. I go, I go, I name. Took him off in a name. Took him off in a name. Stop my truck, it's all jumping.
Thank you.
on the live stream, if you can hear me. We're just moving up for the internment. So this camera will be off for the moment, but stay with us.
Down on the corner and all around.
skies, in a place of natural beauty, yet wishing it were not so, we have brought Frank to his final resting place. Cherish the unique example of Frank's life, so that you may also live in such a way that you are not afraid to die, and that one day others may say of you, as you now say of Frank, thank you, our paths in life crossed, and we are grateful to have walked with you. Our lives have been uniquely touched and influenced by yours, and we are so much the better for knowing you. We shall miss you dearly. May Frank's spirit soar in freedom with the angels and the stars as he takes his own unique place in the universe, watching over you all until you are once more together. We now release Frank's body to its natural end. Frank, we now lay you to rest in peace. Know that you are loved beyond measure, that you will be missed more than words can say, that you will be remembered and cherished, and that love never ends. We will hold you close within our hearts, and there you will remain to be with us throughout our lives. We have rosemary here available for you to strew in final farewell, should you wish. Your unique and cherished memories. And now some closing thoughts in the form of two poems. The Unfinished. We cannot judge a biography by its length, nor by the number of pages in it. We must judge it by the richness of its contents. Sometimes those unfinished are among the most poignant. We cannot judge a song by its duration, nor by the number of its notes. We must judge it by the way it touches and lifts our souls. Sometimes those unfinished are among the most beautiful. And when something has enriched your life, and when its melody lingers on in your heart, is it unfinished or is it endless? At rest, author unknown. Think of me as one at rest. For me, you should not weep. I have no pain, no troubled thoughts, for I am just asleep. The living thinking me that was is now forever still, and life goes on without me now, as time forever will. If your heart is heavy now because I've gone away, dwell not long upon it, friend, for none of us can stay. Those of you who liked me, I sincerely thank you all, and those of you who loved me, I thank you most of all. And in my fleeting lifespan, as time went rushing by, I found some time to hesitate, to laugh, to cry. Matters it now if time began, if time will ever cease? I was here, I used it all, and now I am at peace.
Thank you. I'm going to make sandwich. I got to make while I got the chance. I first met Frank in, I think, 1990, when I was a student in Nottingham at the university. Frank was at Trent Polytechnic, and I lived in the flat, not directly above his, but one across. And the guy who obviously lived next door to Frank and directly below me was obsessed with the Annie Lennox hit Walking on Broken Glass, and he used to play it pretty much on a consistent loop, all the time. It was quite bizarre. And so occasionally Frank would, Frank and I would meet up, we'd have a drink, and that was, I moved out and wound up moving away from the UK. And when I moved back, I was working, doing some cybersecurity work in Sheffield, and I was chatting away to this bloke who was in charge of the IT of the company, and I said, "Oh, where were you a student?" I said, "Oh, I was in Nottingham." "Oh, so was I." "Whereabouts were you a student?" "Oh, I was Trent Poly doing computing." "Oh, that's interesting. Whereabouts did you live?" "I lived in Bridgford." "Yeah, me too." And then we started getting this horrible feeling. And this is in 2008, so this is, you know, 18 years post-event. And I went, I was on Musters Road. And he went, yeah, me too. And I went, did you have a motorbike with an alarm that kept going off at 2 a.m? And he, and trench coat. And he went, absolutely, just blanched and just went, oh. And I went, did you live next door to the guy who used to play Walking on Broken Glass? And he went, oh, I'm so glad, I thought that was you. I thought I'd have to kill you. And so then that was it, you know, big laugh. And we kind of kept in touch, but lost track. And then fast forward to about 2000 and probably 2017, I, for some reason, take a job at KPMG. And I have to send out a Hello World email. And the first response back is from Frank going, what are you doing here? Are you stalking me again? And I've always maintained that I haven't stalked Frank. He stalked me. It's just that he used to get there before I did. But we've, you know, yeah, I know, I'm just so completely heartbroken and so sorry to have lost someone whose life, my life and his were intertwined for so many years. And I am kind of glad that in the end I did manage to actually become properly good friends with him and share so many of his interests. So, yeah, strange days. Anyway, I think that'll do me. So, thanks. Anyway.
So back in 2015, Frank and I were doing one of our many bike rides. Frank was preparing for his Land's End to John O'Groats ride, and he convinced me that I should come along on one of his training rides with him and Pete. Now, I thought I was a decentish cyclist, but very much an amateur, just getting into the sport. And off we went. So we did the first part of the ride. Yeah, we got up to Ashbourne from Derby, and we had lunch. Of course, Pete and I ordered something small. Frank ordered this huge meal, and then he proceeded to set off and go, oh, I'm really struggling to get going now. And Pete and I were looking at each other, thinking, what is he on about? Well, fortunately, Frank got past that phase and really got into his stride. So the next part of the journey from Ashbourne to Buxton is where you're on the Tissington Trail and the hills suddenly start to get serious. Or they were for me. I was very much a novice cyclist in comparison. So about maybe the sixth or seventh hill in, I'm flagging, and next thing I know, I've got Frank Power Assistance. You know, and what that basically consisted of was this big hand on my back pushing me up a hill, you know, whilst I was pedaling frantically, and Frank just took it in his stride. You know, that really cheered me up. And then we set off and he said, right, I'm going to let you go for a bit. So obviously they were doing a training ride, so they were well into the stride. As normal, the pair of them disappeared off into the horizon, you know, waited for me to catch up. And then maybe 5 minutes later, you know, I'm totally out of breath at this stage, struggling to get up this hill. And then all of a sudden, just as I was reaching the brow, I could just hear all this clapping. What Frank had done was commandeered maybe one or two Duke of Edinburgh teams, some teenagers, got them to wait by the side, and they clapped me up the hill. At that point, I didn't know whether to be angry or joyous. And if I'm honest, you know, it really did make my trip that. And I got up that hill, and then we joked and we had a good laugh about it, thanked the kids. And then he proceeded to lie to me then for the rest of the trip, because it was always, oh, Raj, it's just one more hill. It turned out to be maybe three or four more hills to get to Buxton. But, you know, we had a great fun time. Many, many bike stories, I could tell. You know, we did a trip over in Wales, another one from York to back to Derby. Derby's where I live, so that always tended to be the start end point for some of these trips. So, yeah, we had some great fun times. So a different story is when I interviewed Frank when we were at KPMG. Now, in walks this guy, you know, he's way, way taller than I am. You know, I'm about 6 foot, and Frank must be 6'2", 6'3". With me was another colleague called Chris. He was like Frank, basically giant, so I was like little and large in there. And we sat down in the interview, got going, you know, just like any regular interview goes. And then Frank just totally knocked me sideways. But he kept referring to me by name, saying, Raj, so the answer is this. Chris, the answer is that. I'd never come across that before, and he totally put me off my stride, but we got the last laugh because we offered him the job afterwards, and from that point on that's where my friendship with Frank started, and it's been great. It's sad, you know, he's gone, but he won't be forgotten. He's forever going to live in our hearts and our stories. You know, we have regular get-togethers, and he's certainly going to be somebody we talk about well, well into the future.
Yes. So we've got so many fond memories of our time working with Frank at KPMG, but when we were talking about it, I think one of the strongest ones is our cybersecurity team murder mystery event, which Frank did all the filming for, all the editing. He was such a big part of that, and we've got so many good memories, haven't we?
It was really fun. So the premise was that Evany and I were being murdered. I think I was actually personally murdered by Frank. So you could even edit this into to the overall film. It was quite a masterpiece. It started with Star Wars, didn't it?
Yes.
Then with loads of jokes interwoven into it, and then both of us being murdered, and the cyber team from the whole of the country actually had to go around Birmingham and solve the murder. I think it was actually Frank that was the murderer. Oh, well, he definitely killed me on screen.
He did.
I don't know if the plot showed him being murdered, but he definitely put so many hours into it and made a really professional finish. It was just really nice, fond memories with him.
It was. He had such a good sense of humour. It was just really infectious, and I think that whole video, you know, I was re-watching it the other day, and yeah, it's just really nice to remember him by.
I think one of the other things that comes to mind is Evany and I both joined as like non-technical grads, so we were just employed for being able to learn quickly and whatnot. So obviously Frank was way more technical than we could ever dream of being, and would tutor us, wouldn't he? So like, I'm currently revising for the CISP exam, and like in my head when I'm reading it, I'm like, what's the IA? Tell me what it is.
Yeah.
There's a much more rude acronym, but to be fair, I've forgotten it, but it's something about prostitutes, so I'm not going to say it. But
yeah, he's absolutely for remembering everything.
Yeah, the layers of the systems. So, yeah, I will continue to remember him as I revise, for sure. As he really set us on our, like, the beginning of our careers, which we've gone on to. Oh, my Apple Watch, sorry. Anything else? I remember the chili fudge and chili fudge, yeah, definitely. I pride myself on having like a very good spice tolerance, so I remember eating it and just pretending that it wasn't hot. it's fine. Really tasty. Nice heat to it.
Yeah, he'd always bring chili fudge. He's always been in the office in his lycra, no matter whatever the weather, he would cycle into the office.
And those lights, the balls, ball lights, do you remember?
No.
He had these lights that were like testicles, and they lit up and they glowed at the back of his bike. Yeah. It's very sad that he was taken too soon, but definitely will remember him fondly. I'm sure there's loads of
So Frank is known to me as Francis. So Francis is my cousin. And growing up, he's like 4 years older than me, but we were in awe of Francis's abilities for coding and computing. So we were sort of grubby little kids, and was just phenomenally way ahead of us. In so many ways. So I'll always remember him for that. I'll always remember his laugh, which was incredibly addictive. I'll remember him turning up to my wedding. Well, two things from my wedding. One was him turning up to the hotel on a motorbike in full leathers, squeezed into full leathers, and just getting off the motorbike in hysterics. Much to the kind of like dismay of my mother, kind of couldn't quite work out what was going on there. And then also at the wedding, he met my brother-in-law for the first time. And we both realised during the reception, when we were having our champagne, that they both had a love of karate and also sort of medieval weapons. So they, one minute we were drinking at the reception, and then we saw my cousin and my brother-in-law acting out something from Lord of the Rings, much to my mother-in-law's disgust. But he was always and would always be remembered as an absolute character, one of the nicest people you could ever meet. We'll all miss him. Right?
Kind of weird to think of Frank as being gone, to be honest. It's I've only known him for sort of 6 years, really, because it was when I started at KPMG. It was my first time working in cybersecurity. I knew absolutely nothing about it, and the first time I met him, it was very much a case of one of those sort of intro orientation sessions for the new graduate trainees. I was sort of, you know, very excited, a bit nervous, and I remember just walking across the room, and Frank walked straight over to me and goes, "Ah, you're Matthew Grayson McMinn." I was like, "Yes, how do you know who I am?" So, "Your grandfather was in the Navy, he spent time out in Singapore, your dad did this, your mum did this," it was sort of listed off my entire family history in more detail than I actually knew it, from everything he'd been able to find out about me online with a very quick search, which I'd never actually had any idea before applying what cybersecurity was or what it was about, but having that sort of thrust in my face really drove home to me the importance of what Frank did for work. And it really as well drove home to me the sort of person he was. You know, he wanted me to appreciate how important what we do is. And it really got me, he really was the big influence that got me into cybersecurity. And I really very much felt he was a mentor for me the last few years. So it's all gone, yeah, I don't think I'd be the same person I am today if it weren't for Frank. And it's very, very weird to think he's gone. So wherever he is, I'm really very grateful to him, and I'll always be so. And he'll never be far from my thoughts.
My memories of Frank, probably going back about 14 years ago, was when Wendy and myself had a housewarming party, and Frank and Deb came round as family and friends. Frank was in the kitchen, and as you have got, you get all the bottles of booze out and put everything out in the kitchen. And when people came in, we were asking what you want, like whiskey, rum, gin, vodka, everything else. Then Frank came in, who really was quite a complete stranger to the rest of the family and friends. And he absolutely overruled everybody with his expertise at making up unknown, unheard of cocktails, which people were asking for more, more, more. And watching Frank from beyond, I thought, is he going to be able to reproduce what the mixtures are and everything else? And to Frank, as anybody knows Frank, he did. He did. So Frank, thank you very, very much. Happy days, happy memories. Thank you. Okay.
Did you want to do another one?
Honestly, no.
That's
brilliant. That's brilliant.
All right.
Okay, thank you. It's the truth, honestly. Yeah, yeah. You know, when we heard, we thought, you know, right? Because then all of a sudden everything else comes. And then, because I've met these, I'm not sure Frank had met some of these people by this time, but with his jokes and everything else, you know, he didn't need to pay for the entertainer. Just invite Frank, honestly. The biggest, big bloke, as you probably aware, like, you know, what a 10 out of 10 character. What a 10 out of 10 character.
I want to ride my bicycle. I want to ride my bike. I want to ride my bicycle. I want to ride my
bicycle. Races are coming your way.
So forget all your duties, all
go!
Kane.
You say Jones.
I say Wayne.
Hot dog.
I say Cooler Man. I don't want to be the president of America.
I say Smile.
I say Cheese.
Cartier.
I say Please.
Income tax.
I say Jesus. I don't want to be a candidate for Vietnam or water.